Yet despite over 60% of Australians in every single state rejecting racial separatism, the Voice agenda is still being funded with your money and pushed by stealth. We have so-called truth-telling inquiries currently going on in both Queensland and Victoria, not to mention the growing hostility in many Welcome to Country ceremonies. Joining me now to discuss this, former Prime Minister Tony Abbott. Well, I thought we've got two big anniversaries about to land on us, so we need to stop and I think acknowledge where we are 12 months on. The first of those, Tony, is The Voice. Australians spoke very, very loudly, but we feel, I feel certainly, and my viewers tell me, that it's just being forced upon us anyway. I mean, didn't our governments listen to us last year when we rejected all of this?
Well, they should have. But I don't believe they have, because when we rejected The Voice, we were really rejecting the full Uluru agenda, which was voice, treaty and truth. At the moment, the government isn't talking about a voice anymore, but they're certainly encouraging their state Labor colleagues to get on with so-called treaty and so-called truth. Well, we are one country, we're not many nations, and you can't make treaties with yourselves. And our history is something that we should be proud of. It's not a history of shame. Sure, it's not perfect. And this idea that we should retell the story of Australia as one of shame is just absolutely and utterly wrong.
I know you've just come back from a conference overseas, but the Unley Council in South Australia just voted to reinstate its Australia Day events on January 26. You get a sense that the tide is turning. But then we've seen some quite divisive welcomes to country, anything but a welcome in recent times. And I think there is a growing mood amongst Australians, particularly post-Voice, to say enough of being welcome to our own country.
Well, as you know, Peter, I think that the country belongs to all of us, not just some of us. That's why I don't like these welcomes to country, unless it's very specifically a welcome to a particular Indigenous event.
So you wouldn't have them at the AFL?
No. And you certainly, fair enough if you're going to an Indigenous event, say, welcome to the Pitjantjatjara lands or something like that. But the idea that everywhere you go, there should be an acknowledgement that it's not our country, but it's the Indigenous clan's country. The idea that every speaker should stand up and acknowledge country, this is really an act of abasement. It's basically a confession that we shouldn't have settled this country in the first place. And it's a recipe for national neurosis, and that's the last thing we need. I keep thinking of what Bob Hawke so wonderfully said on Bicentenary Day. This is a country with no privilege of origin. This is a country with no hierarchy of descent. And if Anthony Albanese wants to be the successor of Hawke, they're phrases he should remember.
Well, Hawke also famously said, if the bell tolls for Israel, it tolls for all mankind. I mean, 12 months on almost since those horrific events of October 7, I never imagined we would be in a situation where the scourge of anti-Semitism would be so entrenched, so institutionalised, so excused at the highest levels of our government as it is now.
And October the 9th, just a couple of days later, was our day of infamy when you had that crowd shouting unspeakable things in front of the Opera House. What worries me about all of this is that all too often our government is like a helpless bystander. We see these pro-Hamas demonstrators and our government say there's nothing they can do. We see these pro-Hamas encampments on universities and elsewhere. It's a public nuisance. It's a trespass apart from anything
stuff,
else. And again, our institutions say there's nothing that they can or should do. Who knows what's going to happen in the Middle East with Iran and Israel at loggerheads. And all the Prime Minister can say is Australians should leave Lebanon, more helpless bystander stuff. Frankly, we should be sending one of our air warfare destroyers to the Red Sea or the Eastern Mediterranean so that if Iran does send more missiles Israel's way, we can help to take them down. Perhaps we should be sending some of our fast jets to the Royal Air Force bases in Cyprus again, so that we can make a practical contribution to keeping the peace and protecting the only democracy in the Middle East, rather than just wringing our hands and calling for de-escalation. Well, you don't win a war by de-escalation, and Israel is fighting a just war against a series of apocalyptic death cults.